Professor Dave here. Let's work with matrices.
He knows a lot about all kinds of stuff, Professor Dave explains.
Now that we know how to represent systems of linear equations with matrices, we need to learn about what to do with these matrices that will allow us to solve these systems. We want to find out whether a system has zero, one, or infinitely many solutions. And if there is one solution, we want to find precisely what it is. What are some techniques that we can use to do this? The main strategy that we will use involves manipulating the system to produce a new system of equations with the same solution as the original one, but is much easier to solve. How can we do this? Actually, this is still the same concept that we learned in algebra. We can manipulate the equations in a system in any way we want that is algebraically valid, meaning we can do anything we want to an equation as long as we do it to both sides of the equation. Say we have the following system of two linear equations, 4x plus 6y equals negative 2, and 5x minus 3y equals 8. Let's go ahead and generate the corresponding augmented matrix, which will be 2 by 3, with 4, 6, and negative 2 in the first row, and 5, negative 3, 8 in the second row. One option available to us is to take any equation and multiply or divide by some number. How about we take the first equation and divide everything by 2? This shouldn't change the equation or the system, because everything will be in the same proportion. We can also just do this to each term in the first row of our matrix. But just for clarity, let's do both of these things so that we have equations to look at while we do matrix operations. Dividing through, we get 2x plus 3y equals negative 1, and we alter our matrix accordingly. We can multiply or divide any equation in this manner, or the corresponding row, by any number we want except for 0. The reason we divided by 2 is simple, because now we can use another technique. We can take any two equations in the system and add or subtract them to produce another valid equation that will be part of the system. This is another technique we learned in algebra. Now, with the matrix, we want to retain the dimensions of the matrix. So let's say we decide that we want to add the two rows together. Let's do so and replace the second row with our result. We can achieve this by adding the values in the first row to the values in the second row below. To 5, we add 2 and get 7. To negative 3, we add 3 and get 0. To 8, we add negative 1 and get 7. So to summarize, we can add or subtract any two rows to generate a new row without affecting the solution to the system. Combining this with the previous technique, where we could multiply or divide any row by some number, we can actually add or subtract any multiple of any row to any multiple of any other row to get a new row, or even simply swap two rows without changing any of the values, all without affecting the solution to the system. This opens up a lot of possibilities for what to do with a system of equations. Now take a look at what we are left with in the second row. 7, 0, 7. This is the same as the equation 7x plus 0y equals 7. This is trivial to solve. X equals 1. Plugging that into any other equation, we end up with negative 1 for y, and we have solved the system. So as we can see, the key is getting rows with zeros in them. If we took this row and divided by 7, we would get 1, 0, 1, and then we don't even have to use any equations. The matrix spits out the answer. So the goal for any linear system is to write out the augmented matrix and do elementary row operations until each row has a 1 in one of the columns and zeros in the rest, except for the rightmost column, which will give us the value for the variable that corresponds to the position where the 1 is located. When we perform this on a matrix alone, this technique is called Gauss-Jordan elimination. Let's go through one full example together. Take the following equations: x plus 2y plus 3z equals 1, 2x plus 4y plus 7z equals 2, and 3x plus 7y plus 11z equals 8. let's go ahead and construct our augmented matrix, which will be a 3x4 matrix, since we have 3 equations and 3 unknowns. Now, what elementary row operations jump out at us? There are plenty of ways we could do this. One thing we could notice is that the coefficients in the first column are 1, 2, and 3. What if we subtract both the first and second row from the third row to get a new third row? 3 minus 2 minus 1 is 0. 7 minus 4 minus 2 is 1. 11 minus 7 minus 3 is 1. And 8 minus 2 minus 1 is 5. Getting a 0 is always productive, so that was a good start. What next? Let's say we notice that the first two coefficients in the first row are precisely half the corresponding second row coefficients. So what we can do is subtract twice the first row from the second row to get a new second row. So 2 minus twice 1 is 2 minus 2, or 0. 4 minus twice 2 is 4 minus 4, or 0. 7 minus twice 3 is 7 minus 6, or 1. And 2 minus twice 1 is 2 minus 2, or 0. That was a very productive move, because we have just solved for one of the variables. Z must be equal to 0. Now we are in great shape to solve for x and y. Let's subtract the second row from the third row to get a new third row, because that will get rid of this 1 in the third position. And now we have 0, 1, 0, 5. That means y must be equal to 5. And now it's easy to finish things off, because we have two variables isolated. The first row minus twice the third will give us 1, 0, 3, negative 9. And then from that, we can subtract 3 times the second row to get 1, 0, 0, negative 9. Just for the sake of aesthetic, let's swap the position of the second and third rows so that we have the ones along the diagonal. And that leaves us with our solution spelled out for us nice and easy. X is negative 9, y is 5, and z is 0. Once again, we could have ended up with no solutions if the system was inconsistent, or we also could have ended up with infinitely many solutions. But in this case, we got just one. There is a way to tell how many solutions there are once Gauss-Jordan elimination is complete, which will be the case once the matrix is in reduced row echelon form, which can be abbreviated this way. A matrix is in reduced row echelon form when any row with non-zero entries has a 1 as its first entry. This is called a leading 1. Wherever there is a leading 1, all the other entries in that column are 0. And for any row with a leading 1, there is a leading 1 in the row above that is further to the left. Once we have a matrix in this form, Gauss-Jordan elimination is complete, and we can look at the rank of this matrix. The rank is the number of leading 1s. If the rank is equal to the number of columns in the coefficient matrix, the system has at most one solution, meaning this will typically result in a unique solution. If the rank is less than the number of columns in the coefficient matrix, the system has either infinitely many solutions or none, if the rank of the coefficient matrix is less than the rank of the augmented matrix. So as we can see, elementary row operations are no different than what we learned in algebra. It is just that we are applying them to a matrix and getting a solution for the system that does not require manipulating equations by using Gauss-Jordan elimination. This may seem arbitrary right now, but as we proceed through linear algebra, we will learn about all kinds of things we can do with matrices. So let's move forward and continue expanding our understanding of these right after we check comprehension. Thank you. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.